Okay, so we have finished the treatment of the basic amplifier, which is the common source amplifier, and also all the biasing arrangements, okay, which use feedback. Earlier I said that finally we would like to end up with an op amp, which means that we want to make an amplifier with a very high gain. But the common source amplifier we have gives a gain of maybe 10 or maybe at most 100, whatever you do, okay, without raising the supply voltage to astronomical levels. But even if you do that, the inherent gain limitation of the transistor because of its own output conductance will limit the gain. So the only way we saw was if you want a gain of 100,000 or a million or even thousands, you have to put multiple stages one after another. So if you have each stage giving you 20, then three stages will give you 8,000. Okay. And chaining a number of stages, it is known as cascade. Cascading a number of stages, this is in fact required for high gain. Okay. So let us say each stage was giving you some 20 or something, then I will model each one by this, an amplifier. If you put four of them together, this should give you 160,000, and if you put another one, you will get more than a million and so on. Okay. So, what is the complication? Is there any? Why is that a complication? No, swing limits, I mean, we have not discussed them formally, we will do that. But see, in a high gain amplifier, it is assumed that you will apply a small signal, that is why you want a high gain. Okay. So, the output will be limited to whatever. So, let us say the output was, in fact, you have to go the other way around. If you have an amplifier of gain 10 and if the output is limited to plus minus 1 volt, the input will be limited to plus minus 100 millivolts. But if the with the same limits you have a gain of 1000, then the input will be limited to plus minus 1 volt, 1 millivolt, sorry. It has to be that way. But that is not the issue. So, let us see what happens. We also discussed the common source amplifier with parasitic capacitors, right. What did we see? What was the result? What happens when we had parasitic capacitors? We have, of course, some bandwidth limitation. That is, without modeling these capacitors, it looks like independently of the input signal frequency, every signal will be amplified by a certain number. Okay, if you ignore this AC coupling capacitor business. Okay, but with parasitic capacitors, you see that somehow or the other, as frequency increases, eventually the gain goes off to zero at a sufficiently high frequency. Okay, so there is a bandwidth limitation because of this. And more specifically, for the common source amplifier, we saw that you will end up with a second order response. Okay, that is, the transfer function will be of second order. Okay. And in this particular case, we have a second order transfer function. So, because you have parasitic capacitors, it means that there will be some, the parasitic capacitor can be arbitrarily small, okay. But at a sufficiently high frequency, that will also look like a short circuit compared to everything else in the circuit. So, if you, I mean, you can easily imagine, even with a single parasitic capacitor at the output, that will short circuit the output at a sufficiently high frequency. So, you cannot get very, you cannot get gain at infinite frequency, okay. That is some fundamental truth, you cannot do that. So, now, so what? Okay, I will have parasitic capacitors and I will have some bandwidth limitation and I will stay within my limits. Is that okay? That is, it will provide a gain over some range of frequencies. It is not an infinitely large range, but it is some finite range and I can use it in that. Is that fine? Huh? So now, if you just use the common source amplifier, this is fine. You just figure out what is the frequency at which does the gain starts dropping, and you specify it that way, that hey, you can use it only between 0 and this frequency, or some lower frequency limit and this frequency. That's fine. But like I said, what we want to realize is an op amp. And how do you use an op amp? In negative feedback. Okay. So not only do we have to get a large gain, we have to introduce a negative feedback loop around it. Okay. So let's see what happens if you try to make this multi-stage amplifier and put it in a negative feedback loop. Okay. I say an op amp, but in general, if you have any high gain structure, this is in a negative feedback loop. Okay. Remember, the op amp gives you all the good stuff about the op amp when it's used in negative feedback because of the virtual short, right? It gives you a transfer function that is independent of the op amp itself. Okay. And if it has a high enough gain, the transfer function will depend only on the feedback components and so on. For this to work, it has to have a high gain, and to have high gain, you have to have multiple stages. So finally, we have to tackle this business of having multiple stages inside a feedback loop. Okay, is this clear? If you don't use negative feedback, it doesn't matter. Meaning, you just characterize the amplifier; it will have some frequency range, and if you stay within that range, you will get that gain. That's all that's there to it. Okay, we'll see that the more severe problem, that itself you can call a problem, that hey, I'm not able to amplify whatever 100 gigahertz or something. So then you design your amplifier with small enough parasitic capacitors, and maybe you will be able to amplify that also. Okay, but that's not the problem. There is a more severe problem when you try to use this in negative feedback. Okay, any questions about this? What I'm trying to do is first of all motivate the reason for having a high gain and having it inside a negative feedback loop. So before we go on to like looking at what happens when you put a 10 stage amplifier in negative feedback, let's see what happens when you put one stage in negative feedback. Okay. Now, what is the model for my amplifier? The common source amplifier model. This is the MOS transistor. Gate, drain, and source, and we have some capacitor here. I'll just call it CL, and we have this gate drain capacitor there, and then some capacitor over there. Okay, and there is some load resistor. Okay, the input is here. The output is there. So this is just the signal picture of the MOS transistor. I've excluded all of the biasing, all those complications. Okay. So this is what we'll have, and we know that not like this actually, but if it is driven from a source like this, from an imperfect source, it will have two poles under zero. Okay. Now we can try and see what happens if we put this in negative feedback, but let's simplify it even further just to get an initial picture of what's going on. I will even get rid of these things. Okay, so this is my amplifier. That's all. So the input of my amplifier is here, Vi, and the output is Vo. Okay, what will be the transfer function of this? Please evaluate. What is it? What's the DC gain? What is it, Mahesh? Yeah. What is the DC gain? The transfer function of this will just be minus GMRL by 1 plus S. What is multiplying S? Huh? CL. RL. Is that it? What is the difficulty here? Where is the pole of the system? How do you find out? Hey, we did this so many times, right, earlier. What is the, where is the pole of the system? What happens if you deactivate the input? You said Vi to be 0. Obviously, I meant that this is VGS and this is GMVGS. What do we have if we deactivate the input? We just have CL and RLN parallel with each other. So, what if you have a system like that, where will be the pole? I minus 1 by CL RL. Okay, so the transfer function will be minus GM RL by 1 plus CL SCL RL. So, it is a first order system and it has a negative DC gain. Okay. So, I will further abstract this out into just a block. Okay. I will call it A naught by 1 plus S by P 1, just to indicate that it has some DC gain and some pole. Okay. So, this has a DC gain of A naught, which I will consider to be positive just for simplicity. Okay. If it is negative, it's all, it also can be easily analyzed. Okay. It has a DC gain of A naught and the pole is at minus P 1, but in keeping with the circuit convention, sometimes I may say pole P 1, but it is understood that the pole that you start off with is in the left half plane, so that this system by itself is stable. Okay. Then we will put this in negative feedback and see what can happen to it. Is this okay? So, you agree that this is a model for this. So, the only thing I have done is, okay, this actually has a negative gain, but I have taken a positive gain here, but that is a minor change. Is this fine? Any questions? Okay. So, my model for the amplifier has a DC gain and one pole. So, this is a first order case. Remember, even a single common source amplifier gives you second order. So, this is not even modeling properly a single common source amplifier, but it is just to get there that we will use this as a stepping stone. Okay. So, we have some DC gain and some pole, right. Now, let us say this is the gain of our op amp. Okay. I say this is an amplifier, but let us say this is our op amp, right. We somehow say that we have got an op amp with this particular gain. We know that the op amp is required to have a very large DC gain, and for that you need many stages, which means a high order system. But just we are taking baby steps now, and we will think of the op amp as a first order system with some DC gain. Okay. And what is a basic op amp amplifier that you know? Let me take the non-inverting amplifier. Okay. This is not an ideal op amp, mind you. If the difference voltage is Vd and the output voltage is V naught, V naught by Vd equals A naught by 1 plus S by P 1. That is the meaning of saying the op amp has a first order transfer function that is shown here. Okay. In other words, between Vd and Vo, it acts like a voltage controlled voltage source. Again, we won't worry about whether that is really true for the common source amplifier or not. Let us just take this model and move on. Okay. Is this clear? The common source amplifier has a second order transfer function. So, because of parasitic capacitor, you expect at least a single pole somewhere. In fact, frequently lot more than one. Okay. But I will start with the most simple case, that is, I will assume that the op amp has a certain DC gain and it has a single pole at minus P 1. Okay. So, V naught by V d equals this. Please calculate V naught by V I and tell me whether it is stable or not. This kind of thing you have done before, except that the gain of the op amp was just a real number A naught. Now, it also has a certain transfer function, but the procedure is exactly the same. So, please calculate it and tell me what the V naught by V I itself will have some transfer function. So, what I want to know is where its pole is, right. How do you judge whether a system is stable or not? Yeah. So, that is what. So, we will evaluate the closed loop. We know what the open loop transfer function is. Okay. This by itself is stable, but we want to put this in a negative feedback loop and see what happens to it. So we will make all our judgments from the closed loop transfer function. This V naught by Vi is known as a closed loop transfer function. That is the output by input after the loop is closed. Okay. Please calculate the transfer function. Now you have of course solved problems of this type, I assume. So if the gain of the op amp was just A naught, then V naught by Vi, one of the ways of writing it would be K by 1 plus K by A naught. Okay. Now it is not A naught, but it is some function of S. So it is A of S. So all you have to do is substitute A of S over there. Okay. Isn't it? So that is all that is there to it. So what do we get? K divided by 1 plus K divided by A of S, and A of S is that much. So I get K by A naught. What? Yeah, which is the same as this expression, right? You multiply the numerator and denominator by A by K and you will get this. The reason I like this form is this number is expected to be small in an op amp because A is very large. Okay, so the closed loop gain is close to K, isn't it? If A of S goes to infinity, the closed loop gain will be K. So that is why I write it in that form. But yeah, you can also write it as A by what is that? A by K plus A by 1 plus A by K. It is the same. So that is what we get. By the way, if it was still not clear, you can model the op amp as this, where this voltage controlled voltage source has a proportionality constant which is dependent on frequency. It is A of S times Vd, and A of S is A naught by 1 plus S by P1. So that is what I meant. Okay. So using this op amp, if you make our amplifier, this is what you calculated the transfer function for. Okay, because this is a voltage source, connecting resistors does not change the gain, and because no current flows in here, this still behaves like a voltage divider of factor 1 by K. And if this is Vi, this is Vo, V naught by Vi is K by 1 plus K by A naught plus S divided by P1 times A naught by K. Okay. So what is the closed loop DC gain? What is the DC gain of closed loop system? Yeah, K by 1 plus K by A naught. I think this expression you should have seen before for sure. Okay. And if A naught goes to infinity, it becomes K. That is the idea. If A naught goes to infinity, what happens is this Vd will have to go to 0 for any finite output. So this voltage will be the same as Vi, and this will be K times Vi. Okay. So that is the ideal op amp case. A real op amp, A naught will not be infinity, but it will be some large enough number. How large is up to you. Okay. Now of course that is not the purpose why we carried out this calculation. What can you say about the closed loop system? Is it stable? Really? Is it stable or not? How do you tell if the closed loop system is stable or not? What about the pole? If the pole is in the left half plane, it will be stable, okay, because the natural responses of a system will be exponential of pole times t, okay. So if the pole is negative, then the natural responses will die out, and that is what is called a stable system. So in this case, where is the pole? What is the frequency of the pole? What is it? Yeah, so the closed loop pole is at minus P1 times what? 1 plus A0 by K, is it correct? And if A0 by K itself is very large, this could be approximated to minus P1 times A0 by K. That we will see later, if a naught by k is very large, otherwise it is this much. So yeah, the question is it stable or not? It is unconditionally stable, right? We are starting from P1, that is positive. Okay, the op amp itself is stable, it does not have any right half plane poles. Now putting it in feedback cannot shift the poles to the right half plane, that is what I wanted to find out. Okay, because A0 is positive, K is positive. So this whole number, its magnitude can be anything, but the important thing is it is negative. Okay, so if you take a stable first order system and put it in a negative feedback loop, the result will also be another stable first order system. Okay, its dynamics let us worry about later, where the pole is and so on, but you cannot get an unstable system by doing this, is not it? The resulting closed loop system is unconditionally stable, is it correct or not? A naught is positive, that is the definition, right? A naught is negative means that you put the signs incorrectly on the op amp, is not it? That is why we, I mean, this business of putting the signs correctly on the op amp means the DC negative feedback is exists, right? This we have done in EMC and also in this. So if A naught is negative, that means that you flip the signs on the op amp and it is really a positive feedback circuit. So you expect instability there. Okay, A naught is positive. Okay, and P1 is positive because we are starting off with a system which by itself does not have any right half plane poles. Okay, and that was I think okay, because in the common source amplifier also we saw that the poles were in the left half plane. Is this fine? So the summary is that you take a first order system that is by itself stable and it has positive gain. Positive gain here only means that you know which way to put it in negative feedback. Okay, if you do not even know that, then you are finished, right? If you do not know the sign of the system, if you do not know, I mean, if somebody gives you an op amp and I do not tell you which is the plus and which is minus, yeah, you hook it up in some random way and it has equal likelihood of being stable or unstable. Okay, so all that is known. So you put it in negative feedback, but at least that does not do anything bad to it, right? In fact, probably I should not have revealed the plot, I should have just asked you to calculate it for first order, second order, third order and so on and see what happens. But anyway, I already told you that the potential problem might be stability, and first order system it does not look like there is any problem at all. Okay. What did I just tell you? Huh? A naught is positive, right? A naught is negative means that you have not put the signs correctly on the op amp. Okay. For this definition, A naught is positive. Isn't it? I mean, the op amp comes with this marking. What does it mean? This is Vd, this is V naught, and V naught by Vd is greater than 0 at DC. So that's why you put the signs, otherwise why bother? Okay, A naught is positive. Huh? No, I'm not. No, no. A naught is positive. I don't know what the confusion here is. That, no, that I told you that I will take that to be positive, right? I will model it like this. This is not a common source amplifier. If it is a common source amplifier, I will have another inverting stage somewhere so that it will make it positive. Okay. I did not say this is the common source amplifier. Okay. I said I will model it like this, but with a positive A naught. If you really have difficulty with this, you imagine that I have an ideal inverting structure here, and this is the input and this is the output of the op amp. Okay. So do not associate this directly with the common source amplifier. If I do that, A naught will be negative, but I am starting with a positive A naught. But that is easy to arrange. That is, I take the common source amplifier and invert it once more and I will get a positive gain. Okay. Any? There is some difficulty there because one of the sides is grounded, right? So you can't flip it as easily, but there are ways to fix that, let us not worry about. Okay. The point was to do this, right? Let us say you have a block with A naught this, okay? This is your G of S. I think you know enough about control systems to recognize these terms. And you have something in H of S, and when do you say it is a negative feedback? Actually, you do not even look at anything, you just put plus and minus signs there. But if G and this were negative, or this was negative. This is not really a negative feedback circuit at all. Okay. So the moment you write this, it's implicit that at low frequencies G is positive and H is positive. In our case, H is 1 by K. It's the voltage divider ratio. Now if A naught happens to be negative, okay, then what do? This should just be plus for negative feedback, that's all. Okay. So there is a way to make a negative feedback circuit even if the amplifier gain is negative. You just have to flip the way you add things. Okay. You have to change the sign with which you add. Okay, you understand. So if A naught is greater than 0, then this will give you a negative feedback circuit. So then let me take another A naught prime which is less than 0, then this is the negative feedback circuit, right? This is exactly what we do when we assign the signs for the op amp in negative feedback and so on. The op amp has to be operated in negative feedback. Okay. You are just making sure that the you go around the loop, including the summing block and so on. Just make sure that overall sense of feedback is negative. Okay. So just for simplicity, I'll take A0 to be positive. I don't mean that you substitute a common source amplifier there. In that case, the DC gain is negative, but that can be fixed by changing the way you sum things. Okay. This is fine. So if you want a model for it, A0 by 1 plus S by P1, and this is my op amp. This can also be modeled as VD. And I will just reverse the sign of this, whatever this is. This is not the MOSFET, but some control source. Okay. So this will have a positive DC gain and it will have a single pole. Okay. And it roughly looks like the common source amplifier except for the sign reversal. Is this fine? Okay, so we will, so the summary from the analysis of the first order system is that it is unconditionally stable and the closed loop system is also of first order, not surprisingly, and its pole is at this frequency. Okay. So all this means is that if you put a single stage in negative feedback, nothing bad will happen. Okay. But of course, we know that single stage is not going to be adequate because we want very, very large gains. So we have to put multiple stages in feedback, but we will build up from here. Any questions about this? First, don't get confused between the model I showed and the common source amplifier. What I showed is just a model for something that has a DC gain and single pole. Okay. The fact that common source amplifier has a sign inversion, that's not relevant right now. Okay. There are ways to fix that. So let's not worry about it. The main thing is I have a first order system and I'll put that in negative feedback. Okay. And if I do that, you can clearly see that it's unconditionally stable because the resulting pole you can easily evaluate, right? The way of testing for stability is to look at where the poles are, okay? And here you can see that the pole will be in the left half S plane, so it will be stable, okay? Now I want you to do something. So we have been drawing these frequency response plots, okay? So that is the magnitude plot and the phase plot, magnitude on a log-log scale, frequency on a log-linear scale and so on. I want you to do this on the same set of axes for the op amp by itself, that is V0 by VD and the closed loop system V0 by VI. Okay. And remember, this whole all the good stuff about the op amp comes about when A0 by K is very large. So when you do this, you assume that A0 by K is a very large number, and please draw it something that looks resembles to scale and on the same axis. Okay, both plots, the magnitude of this and that should be on the same axis, and similarly the phases. Okay. See? a naught by 1 plus s by p1. So what will this plot look like? Assume a large a naught somewhere. What will it be at very low frequencies? A naught. Okay. I will plot the magnitude but on a log scale. And where will be the break point? At p1. And what happens after p1? It falls at minus 20 dB per decade. Very fancy term. What the hell does it mean? Minus 20 dB per decade. Yeah, what is P2? What does it mean? P1 to 10 P1? Yeah, so 20 dB or a factor of 10. Basically, it says that it is inversely proportional to frequency, right? So, if you go up by factor of 10 this way, you will go down by factor of 10 that way. That is what it means. Okay, fine. So, now V0 by VI, what did we say this was? Okay, now in general the values of K and A0 can be anything, but we know that A0 belongs to an op amp, so it is very likely to be very high, and the whole thing is going to be useful only if A0 tends to infinity or something very large. So, we assume that A0 is very large, and similarly A0 by K is also very large, and so on. Okay. So, what will be V0 by VI at very low frequencies? It is K by 1 plus K by A0, and if K by A0 is very small, then it is close to K. Okay. Then you go to, it will have, okay, it will have a break point. Where will it have the break point? It will be P1 times 1 plus A0 by K, and after that it will fall at also at minus 20 dB per decade. Okay. Are these pictures correct? What is wrong with them? Should cross that. Okay. So, you are saying it should do this. Why? A naught by K is very high. How high is it? I don't know, man. Let's take a million. I mean, I don't care. I can just graduate the axis properly. Huh? Yeah, you find out. I just ask you questions. Okay. Huh? Yes, Bhavya. What happens? Yeah. That is the whole point. This starts from A0 and then it starts falling off at P1. Okay. Forget about where this red line actually starts bending. Tell me what the value of this blue line is when it crosses the red line. I have just drawn a red line at K. It is not the frequency response of anything. I just had a fetish and I drew a line at K. Okay. So, where does this blue line cross the red line? At what frequency will it do that? P into A0 by K. Is that correct? Because this has to fall from A0 to K. That means it has to fall by a factor of A0 divided by K. So, when will it do that? It has to also go out by a factor of A0 by K. Is this clear? So, this 20 dB, minus 20 dB per decade line represents inverse proportionality to frequency. So, if this has to fall from A0 by K, this has to go up from P1 to what frequency? P1 times A0 by K. Okay. Now, where is the break point of the closed loop response? P1 times 1 plus A0 by K. But if A0 by K is very large, the distinction between A0 by K and 1 plus A0 by K is negligible. Is this clear? So, actually what happens is that this comes here, and if you want to be really picky about it, just go slightly outwards, but not substantially, especially for useful values of A0 by K, because again you know, as a problem, you can take any values of A0 by A0 and K. K could even be less than 1. But of course, we are talking about amplifier here. K will be more than 1 and A0 will be much, much more than 1. Okay? So, the picture will look like this and it will follow that line. Okay? No, no, I said little bit further. Actually, it doesn't go further. It's only if you think of it as a Bode plot asymptote that it goes further. Basically, it follows this line. Okay, it has to. That we'll see later. Okay. So it goes up to P1 times A0 by K, and it does that. Okay, we are drawing these straight line asymptotes. So there, if you do that, it'll look like it'll go up a little further. But it's really not these straight lines, right? There is a smooth bending here as well as there. Okay. So, this scaling should come out properly in graphs. Okay, anytime I ask you to sketch, I mean, I see all kinds of pictures. This is not what I want to see. Okay, so I've repeatedly told you that, I mean, sketching is also a way of understanding problems and a very powerful one, because for things you cannot carry out any analytical calculations, it's very useful. Okay, the phase quite routine. At P1, it has a minus 45 degree phase lag and it will reach minus pi by 2, and similarly for this it will go up there and it will do that. Okay. Now, this plot, it will turn out as very useful later, because for a first order system it was easy. I could calculate the closed loop transfer function, and what is there in factorizing a first order polynomial? It's very easy. I can just look at the denominator and say where the pole is. It's in the left half plane. It's stable. We are done. Second order, you can see things will get a slightly complicated. At least there is a formula. What will you do for third order? Do you know how to factorize a third order polynomial? How about sixth order? Can you do that? Can anyone do that? Sixth order. Huh? Factorize. Are you aware of this or no? You cannot write an expression for polynomials of degree greater than 5, for expression for the roots in terms of its coefficients. Okay, this is a very important result in mathematics. I mean, I cannot do even second order probably, but we are not talking about me here. No, nobody can write an expression. Okay, so. It will be the same. Okay, it should be the same. Why should it be less? I don't know. No, no, that's not related to this. This is a Bode plot, right? There are many approximations here. So, that's fine. So, anyway, so for higher order systems, you can't factorize the polynomial easily. So, we have to resort to these things and you have to be able to sketch these things properly. Okay, we'll continue from here for higher order systems.